considered, and wherever we can submit the proposals. All these things you can learn from this 5 days workshop. I should thank the department, which has been recently accredited by NBA, for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this 5 days workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the
for
two
organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the department, as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main workshop. I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as which has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main workshop. I should
thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop. I should
thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently
accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main workshop.
I should
thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop. I
should
thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently
accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop. I
should thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently
accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this
kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop. I
should
thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently
accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I should
thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently
accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop. I
should
thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this
kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop. I
should thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this
kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop. I
should
thank the
department,
as well as
which
has been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this
kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main workshop. I
should
thank the
department, as well as
which has
been recently accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this
kind of FDP.
You can learn from
this main
workshop. I
should thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for
organizing this
kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I
should thank
the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently
accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing
this kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop. I
should thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this
kind of FDP. You can learn from this
main workshop.
I should
thank the
department, as well as
which has
been recently accredited by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this
kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main workshop.
I should
thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently
accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this
kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop. I
should
thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this
kind of FDP. You can
learn from this
main
workshop. I
should thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently
accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this
kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop. I
should
thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently
accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this
kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I
should
thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been recently
accredited
by NBA,
So these are the two
for organizing this
kind of FDP.
You can learn from this
main
workshop.
I
should
thank the
department,
as well as
which has
been
recently
First one is what steps do I need to take before I am a manager? we all look for. And our various universities have different norms on how many papers you require and which kind of indexing you require and so on and so forth. So typically, we all have looked for 10 pages, and our various universities have different norms on how many papers you require and which kind of indexing you require and so on.
If there are participants,
we all have looked for 10 pages, and our various universities have different norms on how many papers you require and which
every chapter of your PhD and so on.
If you look towards the end, just before the conclusion, most of the papers have research challenges, and in that, in those challenges, about 8 to 10 different points need to be mentioned. And before the conclusion, take about most of the papers have points among those challenges, and in that, in those challenges, about 8 to 10 different points are doing a master's or MTech. And the conclusion, take about most of the papers have points among those challenges.
It's very important that in that way, those challenges about 8 to 10 different points are doing a master's or MTech. And the conclusion, take about most of the papers have points. It's very important that the survey papers are much higher compared to a
So it is basically reflects the However, most of the researchers do not consider H index as very, very important, because if you look at the second point, it says each of papers. So I may have, let's say, 50 papers, and my 51st article cites all of those 50 papers. So this is known as self-citation. So that really is not very helpful, because as a researcher, I need other researchers to really use my work. But there is something which is known as the I index, I tend other index. However, which is more work, not in my opinion, because it shows you very, very important work, because if you look at the second scholar or any scholar has done, and that work being used by others. Point. So each of papers. So I may have, let's say, 50 papers, and my 51st article cites the work those done by him or her. So this is known as self by other people. So that really is not very
so as a researcher, we should always look at
such kind of
I need other researchers by
to really use my work,
and which will be used by others.
So
if you
have all the scholar, there is something which is known as
I
each of them, it will also give you the different metrics, like the citation. So I may have, let's say, 50 papers, and my 51st article totally cites the work done by him. So this is not self by other cited. So that's really not very
good. So as a researcher, we should always look at.
There is also said
over 60 other researchers who really use my work,
and this kind of thing.
So if you have all the
good
research,
again, I would like to stress that the whole idea of research is that you are so good that others are not using it. Because it shows you very well.
the major points is more than enough. You don't have to write paragraphs on paragraphs to explain one graph. So the requirement is to write with brevity and not with verbosity, because journal space is very, very important. The publisher, while printing, is going to be very, very strict on the number of pages. And I think the participants would have also come across this strict measures by the journal, where it says that maximum number of pages is 10 or 12, and beyond that you need to pay, let's say, $100 per page. So we need to fit in everything in those number of pages. For example, IIT Journal of Research by Taylor and Francis, which is a very good national journal, allows only 6 pages, and beyond 6 pages you need to pay 1,000 rupees per page, right? So so when you have these kind of strict norms, we need to be very strict with our languages. I will leave the scientific language in terms of English here, because most of us have been doing English since childhood. So these are the requirements that we require. Of course, there's a whole separate session on which tense to use, which grammar to use, and so on and so forth. But I will leave it here with the participants. So please do not ignore this. I have come across many occasions where the researcher who has submitted the article has got really good results, but the explanation of those results, even after 2 or 3 reviews, have not been to the mark, and therefore, unfortunately, such articles have to be rejected. So let that not be a case, and the language is as important as the scientific part. That means, the research part. This is the second objective. How do we build up the article properly? This is a major issue. And there is no hard and fast rule on how to build the article properly. Likewise, there is no hard and fast rule how you read an article. For example, some people start with the abstract, some people start reading with the introduction, some people directly go to where the experiment or the simulation has been done, some people read the conclusion. So likewise, how do you build the article is also, that also comes with experience. But there's a certain flow which is required. So I would like to highlight that. So this is a general structure of any research or a full article. I'll be focusing on the research article because most of us are focused on that. A survey article requires a different kind of effort. That probably I will be including tomorrow when we are doing the project proposal, because project proposal requires a thorough literature survey. So let's look at the research article. So every section has a definitive purpose. So you have the title, you have the abstract, you have the keywords. These should be very easy. These three are used for indexing purpose and for searching. So it should be easy, because if once your article is published and someone else wants to search, articles on a certain, domain, your article should stand out through the title or the abstract or the keyword. So it needs to be very easy, it needs to be informative, attractive but not fancy, and it needs to be effective in the terms of searching. So this is basically how we write the article. You have the introduction, the methods, the results, and the discussion. Like I've already pointed out, journal space is very precious. Make your article as brief as possible. So we have a whole lot of results with us, and we have a lot to say about those results, but we should know exactly how to really point out the most important parts of the results which we have obtained through experiments or simulation. Then you have the conclusion, the acknowledgement, the references. The references are very, very important. Again, from my experience, I see that not a lot of attention is paid on the references, but journals are very, very focused on how the researchers have referenced, because this is a way of thanking the other researchers and the authors of a book. So it needs to be in a specific format, and then you have if you have any supporting materials. So basically, the progression of any article is general to particular to general, but we write it in the following order. We focus more on the results part, which is figures and tables. Then we focus on methods, results, and discussion. Then comes the conclusion, then the abstract. It should actually be the abstract, the title. Then the introduction is very, very important. From my experience, I've seen that the introduction by most of us is very, very long, which really consumes
whole lot of journal space, the introduction needs to be very small. So in you know, the later slides, I'll just give you examples of how the introduction and other points of a journal article should be written and how you can enhance them. So let's look at how the title should be. So from now on till the towards the end of this presentation, I'll be using examples only from my study. So you will not see the, you will see that I've not used any references because these are only my study. So I'm using the examples from my study. So what about the title? The title should attract the reader's attention. It should be specific. It should be informative. Avoid using jargons. Jargons would mean you know, the words which only a certain community would know. You don't know a reader from you know, not your community may want to read or not from your domain would also want to read your article. So it should cater to the needs of all the readers. So avoid jargons. Avoid the abbreviations. So this is one of the examples which I've used, ESSON. So it's a short title. It tells you elastic spectral and spatial optical networks. Right? So it tells you that it is about optical networks. It tells you that there's some elastic part in spectral and spatial optical networks. Right? So it basically gives you a whole idea about what the title should be. There are much better titles than this, but it took me about 10-12 years to really frame these kind of titles. Initially, I was also very bad with the titles, and in the next slide, I am going to show you the mistakes which I have made. So, phrases to avoid: investigation, study, novel, facile. Avoid acronyms that are known only to specialized community. So, you see these four titles. These are titles from my articles. So, if you go to Google Scholar or Scopus and type these articles, you will see that they are associated with my name, and you can see I have highlighted in black the mistakes which I have made. So I've used the term study, then I used the term PLIARWS. So those of you who are not from the optical network background will not really know what this PLIARWS is. Those of you who are not from the optical network background or communication background will not know what is this WDM. Then I've also used investigation, the word investigation in the third point. Then in the fourth point, I've used the word. So these are some of the words which we should avoid. It's not that if you use these words, your article will not be accepted. It's not like that. But it is better to avoid. The reviewers, excuse me, the reviewers and the editors do not tend to, you know, really flow with these kind of words. So these are some of the words which should be avoided. So I learned from these small errors which I made earlier in my career. And then now I have framed titles which look like this. So you can see that I have now really defined what is WDM, you know, wavelength division model. So anyone who is not from the communication or networking background will also know what WDM is. And then in the last topic, I have really, really, you know, made it very specific how to, you know, write the title properly so that anyone who is reading will understand what actually it is. So these are just some suggestions on the title. From my experience, reviewers and editors really don't like those kind of words like novel, study. Novel is not accepted anymore. So please don't use novel in the study at all. Investigation, you will still find a few titles like that. Some reviewers are still okay with that. Study, they're still kind of okay with that. But novel, absolutely not. So please avoid using the term novel. Abstract, very, very, very important. The researcher, the upcoming researchers, people who are pursuing PhD must focus a lot on the abstract because this is really the advertisement to your research work. Even we guide the UG students in their final year projects or, you know, any six semester project, the abstract is very important. We really don't look through the abstract, and, you know, because any report that you submit, if it is going online or if it is going for evaluation, abstract is the, you know, the first thing that anyone is going to see after the title. So people may not really, you know, skim through the entire study, but they're really going to read the abstract. So a whole lot of effort needs to be put on the abstract. It needs to really show the major findings of your study. It needs to be short. It should be the abstract should be such that once I read the abstract, I should be really curious what the entire study is. You know, if everything is put in the abstract, then nobody is going to read the entire article. At the same time, if you put nothing in the abstract, then people are going to lose interest. So there is a fine line between how you generate this curiosity. So really, it needs to advertise your articles. How many paragraphs to use, how many words to use, that will depend on the journal and the conferences. So I'll be giving you some examples of how the abstract should look like. So in this slide, you'll see that I have highlighted certain words, and then the next part of the sentence has been, I've scratched the sentence, and the text is also almost not visible because I don't want the participants to read what has been scrapped. I only want the participants to focus on what has been highlighted. So this is an example of an abstract. So I start with, in the current work, we address. That means in this current work, the authors are addressing something. Now, what is that something? We did not focus because it is domain specific, but I want the participants to really understand that I'm generating a curiosity in the reader by saying that, or by stating that in this current work, we are addressing something, right? So as a reader, if you read, I'm reading in the current work, we address. Okay. So now I'm curious, what are the authors addressing, right? So I address something. Then initially to obtain, when I write initially to obtain something, the authors have formulated something. So now the reader is really involved in the study and saying, okay. So initially they want to obtain a certain result, and for which they are really formulating something. And then you have next, we propose. So in the next part, they are proposing something, right? So in these two points, I am generating more and more curiosity in the reader by saying that, to obtain something, I'm formulating something, and then we also propose something. Then to achieve the above points, we conduct some simulations or some, experiments. Then the obtained results show us so and so. So if you look at the steps of this abstract, the flow of the abstract, it generates a curiosity in the reader, and then it tells the reader how we are able to achieve a certain thing which we are proposing, and then it also tells the reader by doing some kind of experiment or simulation, we have obtained some results which show so and so. So this abstract is giving the reader some information, and it has generated curiosity for the reader to really read the article. So I'm giving you two examples. The first one is of a 200 word abstract. So there's a proposed solution which is already there. There is a problem with the proposed solution. Therefore, in this current work, we formulate so and so. Also, we propose so and so. So now as a reader, I know that, okay, I may have read some other article where I have already seen a solution. But when I come to reading this particular article, I can see that the authors are saying that proposed solution, which you have read in some other article, has a problem. So now I'm curious to see, okay, I'm already aware of this problem, but aware of a solution, but that solution is having a problem. So now I'm curious to know, okay, what have the authors done in this particular article? So then I see that, okay, in this current work, the authors are formulating something, and then the authors are also proposing something. So now I'm more curious. Okay, the solution which is existing is having some problem. Now, how are these authors going to solve it? And then how are they performing the simulation or experiment, and how are they evaluating it? Right? So I tell the readers, what is the problem? What is the solution existing? But what is the problem in this existing solution? Therefore, what am I proposing? What am I formulating? And then how am I re-justifying that my study or my solutions are better than the ones which are existing? So I'm really forcing the reader to read my entire article. That is the whole job of an abstract. So now all the participants can see that this was a 200 word abstract. So I have a lot of words which I can use, a lot of paragraphs which I can use, and I can really, really be free in writing, because you can see that I have occupied so much space in writing the abstract. So this was the freedom which was given to me by this particular journal, that I could write for 200 words. Now, I'm showing you an example of 35 words abstract. So this is a case where if my words go to 36, the journal will not accept my submission because the constraint is 35 words. So I cannot use is, the, and very freely. I need to be very, very appropriate with the usage of the words. And this kind of an abstract really takes you months. So just to let you know, this abstract formulation took me 3 months. It's just 35 words. But in this 35 words, I have to really generate curiosity and I have to really tell the user, the reader, what exactly this work is doing, right? So we investigate, that means the authors are investigating something and the results demonstrate so and so. Here I am really hopeful in this 35 words abstract, I'm really hoping that the reader is already aware of existing solutions. So if you compare this abstract with the previous 200 words abstract, there I had the freedom to tell the user, the reader, that there is already a solution which is existing, but it has a problem. Whereas in the 35 words abstract, I don't have that much space. So here I'm more hopeful that the reader really is up to date with the state of the art. And he or she knows that, okay, there's a problem with existing solution. And therefore I really just start with we investigate. So we investigate something and the results demonstrate ones. So here we really need to, as a writer, a research writer, I really need to be quite experienced and I need to use my words properly. So 200 words abstract can be done by somebody who is initially in their research career and, you know, they have space to use the word. 35 words abstract, it requires experience because there's a lot of focus, you know, the lens on what this 35 words abstract would be. Things can get even tougher where you could have 35 character abstracts. Therefore, there using an ampersand or a comma or a semicolon also increases the number of characters. So we really need to be careful. There are certain journals like letters. You have many letters that journals offer, which can be only, you know, one page and, you know, the abstract is some 10 characters or 20 characters. There are different kinds of such submissions. So we need to really experience. So here our writing skill really comes on the forefront. And next is the keywords. Keywords, is there's not much to explain in the keywords, and I'm sure all participants are aware, but keywords are used to really search for your study. So give the apt keywords. Don't give the keywords which are really not associated with your article. So it's always good to give the most appropriate keywords. They will be used for the as a label to your manuscript or the article. And if you are into mathematical study, then you also need some mathematical keywords. And there are different labels for mathematics and basic sciences and so on through. So there is also a limit on the number of keywords which you can use, say 4 or 6 and so on and so forth. But it's always used, always suggested to use about between 4 to 6 keywords in any kind of research article. Next is the introduction. Like I've already mentioned before, I've seen that many researchers are very verbose in the introduction. And that verbosity comes from the fact that we like to use a whole lot of existing study. Please understand that the research article is about your study. It is not about someone else's study. So by using the journal space to mention a whole lot of someone else's study really does not benefit you. The introduction needs to be crisp. The introduction must necessarily state the novelty of your work. Please do not hide the novelty of your work. You need to be very, very open with the novelty of your work. So towards the end of the introduction, just before we state, you know, the article is, you know, structured as follows, section 2 does this, just before that, a small paragraph of what is the novelty of your work needs to be specified, and this needs to really be highlighted, because a whole lot of study which I have experienced as a reviewer, they mention a whole lot of existing studies, citing, you know, in the introduction itself you can see that researchers have cited about 20 to 25 studies. You know, it's not required to do so. Keep the introduction of existing studies to the minimum. you know, the introduction can be made minimum if your study which you are really reading is only, you know, about 2 to 3 years prior to the current year. So we are in 2020. If we don't go beyond 2017, therefore, then our introduction will become very small. But if we are trying to cite, you know, some study which is 2013, 2015, you know, now 2015 studies also have become old, you know, especially in very focused areas. Take communication, things change within 6 months. So 2015 studies really don't, matter. And if they're really, really, really good studies, then a book is already published on them. But there are some studies which will be old because they are the, you know, norm studies. For example, if I want to cite Shannon's capacity theorem, then that study will always be in 1947 because Shannon's paper was in 1947, right? But it's better to cite a book which tells us about Shannon's capacity theorem, which is, you know, 2010 or 2015, rather than the original manuscript of Shannon's theorem. Just an example how we can make our introduction small, right? So really we need to highlight what is the novelty of the study. Unfortunately, many research papers miss that, and the editors are very, very specific about that, and it goes back to the author. If the editor is giving them a scope to revise and resubmit, great. If the journal is very high impact, then it just gets rejected at the editor level itself. So we need to be very crisp with our introduction. Please highlight the novelty. So I would suggest if there are participants who are in their early research career, when you write the introduction, please write the novelty of your work. Novelty is a different case. Extension is a different case. Please have a difference between the two. Novelty is what is new. Again, novelty does not mean invention or discovery. It means what is new in your study, which is not there. And extension is a different case where the study is already existing, right? There's a fine line between them. So this has to be highlighted properly. So there are different case things which need to be used in the introduction. I've just given you an example how we can make the introduction much better. So again, I'm showing you an example of the introduction. I don't want you to focus on the lines which are scrapped and which are really, you know, light in the text, but concentrate on the words which are highlighted. So in the introduction, I'm showing something and may requisite, means may require. So I'm showing what is the problem or what is the requirement. So as a reader, for the reviewer as well as the reader, I'm saying that there is something which is existing, but this may require something. So what is the problem? Next, this can be accomplished. That means you can do whatever is required can be done. So I'm telling the reader and the reviewer what is the existing solution, right? So I'm not hiding that. I'm not saying that I'm the first one to really, you know, do that. I'm saying that there is some problem and it may require something, but this can also be accomplished. So there is an existing solution. However, now I'm telling the reader what is the limitation of this existing study. So you can see the flow. So I'm not hiding the fact that there is a problem. I'm not hiding the fact that there is an existing solution, but there is a problem with this existing solution. So as a reader, that I know that, okay, now this author is going to solve this existing solution, right? So I already know, and I already know the next line which is going to come, right? So I'm telling the reader right now what is the limitation of the existing solution. So I'm telling the reader that, it may result in use of something less. It may lead to some unneeded loss of something, you know, right? So I'm telling the reader something like that. And then I'm telling the reader in the current work. So now in this work, I'm showing that, right? And then I'm telling the reader that this kind of an investigation has not been done yet. And I am able to demonstrate as the author some gains, some profit, right? So I'm telling the reader the solution and the novelty of my study, right? And then I have the last part. So you will not believe this is the introduction of one of my journal papers. So this is just 3/4 of the first page, and this does with the introduction. So you can read, you can see in the last lines, rest of the paper is structured. So that ends my introduction. So like I've mentioned to you, introduction does not have to be 3-4 pages and consuming a lot of journal space. It only needs to really tell you, that tell the reader and the reviewer what is what is the problem? Is there any existing solution? What is the problem with the solution? How is your solution better than the existing solution? And that's it. Right. So I've not used a whole lot of studies to cite and other kind of things as well. Rather, if you really look at the light, text, you will see that I've only used about 7 references. Right. So it also saves my space towards the end, because instead of having, 30 references, I'm just going to have around 10 to 15 references. Right. So this saves paper. The idea of saving journal space is that I'll have more space to talk about my own study. The research article is all about talking about our own study. Next is any assumptions and methods that you have. The methods could be experiment or simulation. If you are into communication like myself, then we are mostly dealing with simulation work. If you are into basic science or any other department, I'm not really sure, you may have experimental test method. So you need to specify what are the methods. You need to specify what are the assumptions. The room temperature is assumed to be so and so. If you are doing any kind of software, we assume that the network is local area network. The demands are so and so. So all those kind of things. What software or hardware you are using? If it is a software, which version you are using? Because these are the small things that the reviewers as well as the readers would want to. So I'm just giving you an example. This will definitely differ with the domain. So I'm just telling, the assumption is we are considering some realistic topology. It is mentioned in the figure as well as the table. We are using some algorithm, then the demands are so and so. They are averaged over so and so. And then we are using some kind of model. And then I have lastly stated what kind of software is used. So I'm using a Cplex software, and I'm also using the MATLAB software. So the version is not mentioned here because the version is mentioned in the references. If you don't want to mention the reference, the versions in the reference, you can mention the version here. So these are some of the things in the assumption and methods which you must give. If your study is a real-time study, then in that case, assumptions will not come into the picture. But the methods have to be, really elaborated, because the readers need to know what kind of methods have you used. Next, the results. Again, from my experience, I've seen here in the results is that people like to, the researchers like to show a whole lot of results, wherein the results can actually, be combined into one result, and it looks much better. Try to keep the results consolidated. Present only the primary results. Please do not present results which are very obvious, or which people know. If I increase this something on y-axis will increase. If it is a known fact, please do not do that. I mean, it's just a waste of space. The reviewer is not going to be impressed. The quantity of your result really does not matter. It is really the quality of the results. So try to consolidate the results, and if it is a graphical result which I've put on the slide, then you can see that a whole lot of results can be put into one graph. If you have a tabular result, then a whole lot of information can be put inside the table itself. So this also requires a skill and experience, but try to keep it to the minimum and explain it to the minimum. So I put in okay, and next comes the discussion part, which is a part of the result. That's exactly what I was seeing. So discussion can be a part of the result, or if you want to discuss in a separate section or a subsection, you can do that as well. It is the most important section, because this really is your work. Discussion and results should go hand in hand. You should not show the results and the discussion is something else. You should not do that. Please do not mention the existing results in the discussion. The discussion should have only your results. They should discuss only your results, right? So I just used an example of the dart there. You can have good accuracy but poor precision. You can have poor accuracy but good precision. But in research, you are looking at good accuracy and good precision, right? So you have got good results, but the discussion may not be good, vice versa. But that's not what is required. You need to have good results with good discussion. Right? In some cases, you may have to compare your results with the already published results. That depends on the nature of the study. So I just put in an example, so you can see that there are two graphs here, A and B, and a whole lot of information is put inside the graph as well. Therefore, the text on the top is only 4 lines. I don't have to explain a lot. Rather, with surety, I can say that the reader does not even have to read the text because the graphs are self-explanatory. Right? So we should have graphical results or tabular results such that just by going through those graphs or the tables, the reader is able to really understand the whole lot of results. If there is something which is complicated, for then he or she can refer to the text which we have written. Right? So we really have to think as a reader when we are writing the discussion part. Therefore, if it is a long story with a lot of paragraphs, it's not going to be very interesting for the reader. So try to consolidate all the results, be it graphical or tabular or any other form of results. Then conclusion, it needs to be very, very clear. The conclusion cannot be a copy paste of the abstract or the copy paste of the introduction. Okay, it needs to be a conclusion. Justify your work in the field. It is okay to share the plans. Please share your plans. In my experience, I have seen that many researchers don't want to share the plans. See, research is all about, it's a community. So share your plans, tell people what is the future scope or what can be investigated more. So these kind of things must be mentioned. In fact, some reviewers and editors really want you to share the open problems. So don't hide anything. It's all good to share. So just an example of a conclusion. So in the current work we focused on, to the best of our knowledge, our study is the first. We compared and we also compared. So what exactly did we do? We compared our work with some other work. The obtained results demonstrated and the results showed so and so. As a scope for future research, we will aim to. So these are the 2 points which we have put towards the end, which is telling the research community domain that these are the things that we are trying to do in the further work. So it's okay. Someone else also picks this up and gets the result. You also do the work and get the result. Okay, there are two results which can be done, and then you can see which is the best result. So we are only enhancing the research community rather than trying to hide what can be done. Then you can put in the acknowledgement. Generally, acknowledgements come in the form of a funding agency. If you are funded by an agency, you have to acknowledge them. You know, acknowledge the advisor. Usually we don't acknowledge the advisor because the advisor is a co-author. Some journals, mostly industry articles, will acknowledge proofreaders, typists, and suppliers. This may not be the case with academic research. So just see how you can acknowledge. Here also, in some articles I've seen that people acknowledge personal friends or relatives. That's not allowed. It's a technical it's a technical write-up, so it has to be very professional. References, as I stated, very, very, very important. Please do not use many references. A survey paper will have many references, but that also try to concise. A survey paper, if in my opinion, if you are writing in 2020, please do not go for studies below 2017, 3 years or below, because usually in about a year or two, you get a survey paper on the previous results. So going lower than 3 years will only dilute the survey, as well as it will also enhance the work because you'll have too many references to refer to. Avoid excessive self citations. It will increase the H index, but we are really looking to increase the I10 index. So avoid excessive self citations. Point number three, it's a dubious point. Avoid excessive citations from the same region. In some cases, it could be true. I don't know. I mean, participants can make their own judgment on that. But certainly, I'm very sure on point number two, avoid excessive self-citations. Conform strictly to the guide of the journal or conference. If it is IEEE format, it has to be IEEE format. If it is ACM format, it needs to be ACM format. So on and so forth. So there are different kinds of versions here. These are some of the examples. I've shown IEEE, I've shown ACM, I've shown the other kind of references. So whatever is the case, it needs to be properly done. If you are using Word to format references, you need to be extra careful. If you are using LaTeX, LaTeX is very easy. It does the things for yourself, I mean by itself. But if you are using Word, then you have to be really, really careful. And all details about the references have to be really presented, be presented. So overall, this is the structure of any research article. You have the abstract, you'll have the introduction, the review, very, very important, any methodology, results, discussion, conclusion, acknowledgements, and references. And I've also highlighted a few of the things which are mentioned here. So once I share the slide, you can go through that. You can have a cover letter. In some journals, cover letter is mandatory. In few journals, it's not, but it's always good to have a cover letter. You can tell through the cover letter what will make your article, you know, special, so to say, for this particular journal. In the cover letter, you can also mention reviewers if you are asked. Some journals ask for a set of reviewers. You can mention that if you have any conflict of interest and so on and so forth. Very important issue, plagiarism. There is a software, Turnitin is the one that is used. A better one used by really high impact journals is Authenticate. But I want to focus here. These softwares will check only the text, sentences, or paragraphs. So let's say I put my file through Turnitin and it gives me 20%. I go rewrite and then check through Turnitin again. Now it gives me 15%. I rewrite again and bring it down to 12%, 8%, so on and so forth, right? So Turnitin or Authenticate, these are only going to check for text, sentences, and paragraphs. What about ideas and concepts, right? That is known as patent landscaping. For example, I have an idea and I have put that in an article or in a patent, and someone else has taken the idea and written the manuscript such that it comes clean through the software, the Turnitin or Authenticate. Then what about that? So for this, the reviewers and the editors need to be really state of the art researchers to really understand that this idea or concept has already been addressed to, and this amounts to patent landscape, right? So for very high impact journals, patents, we go through to the level of patents to see whether the work is plagiarized or not plagiarized. But overall, be very aware of plagiarism. Self-plagiarism is also an issue. Journals will return back. Some journals are quite sensitive. They will return back the article to you once or twice in case of self-plagiarism. Some really don't have time, so they'll just return it back to you, right? So don't copy-paste a paragraph from your own study and put it in your next article. You need to really reframe and come out with good ideas. So this is a very important issue these days. So you can ask someone to proofread your article, a colleague or a review. And always please be open for any criticism, because criticism is only going to enhance your article. And then submit your article. So always get it proofread or revised at least one or two times before. As you go ahead with your experience, once a revision once is more than enough. But in the initial stages, at least 2 to 3 times by someone else is very, very important. After submission, I'm sure you all are aware, you can have accept with the revision, major or minor, or a reject. Revision, once it is rejected, we don't like it, of course. And some of us may not take the reviewer's points, in the way it should be taken. Our first idea that we have about reviewers is he or she has not understood what I've tried to say, right? And they've not understood, or they are, they don't want my study and they only want study from their own people. And we have many, such misconceptions. But that is not so, because reviewers are also answerable. They are answerable to the editors, and the editors are answerable to the publishers. Therefore, that kind of misconception should not be there. Of course, there's reviewers are humans, of course. They are also researchers. If you think they have misunderstood a point which you are trying to put across, it's always respectfully or politely, you can always disagree with them. Reviewers don't mind. know, there are some points which the reviewers may have stated which really does not apply to your study. So you can always be polite rather than, you know, having an attack on them. Submit the revised article, and then you will get a galley proof, and this will be the final, you know, your final article before it is actually published. What to do if the paper is rejected? Don't be discouraged. I know it is easier said than done, but I've gone through this myself, so I know it is not easy to, you know, not being discouraged, because when you put in a whole lot of effort into it, and if you're certainly when you're doing PhD and you're waiting for you know, acceptance that you can finish your PhD and many other commitments, it's not easy to be, you know, discouraged, but that is the only way out. Many of us we turn around and just submit to other journals in a hope that, you know, those points will not be you know, addressed. If you're not lucky enough, the same reviewer may come in the journal as well. So it's better to address those points, the points of the reviewers, and then revise it, and then go for a resubmission, mostly in the same journal if they allow you a resubmission, or you can look for any other you know, journal. What to avoid? Data without any application review of literature. If it is not there, don't submit at all. The article will apply to you. Any incremental advance, that is extensions, is not being considered suitable for publication. So really, extension work should not be you know, one of the things that you are doing. To do even better, please don't use this you know, idea of English is not my native language. That's not a justification we can use, or that's not a justification the reviewers can also use. Badly written papers, what I see these days is it's just returned back within a week. If it is a very high impact journal, within a day, right? So the papers have to be written properly. English has to be good, not fancy, I say again, but it needs to be good. And overall, the article needs to make sense at the very first reading, and then it will go to you know, to the next processes. Because please remember, the reviewers are not getting paid, or they're not getting anything for reviewing. It's just you know, they're contributing to the scientific community. Therefore, sending the articles to the reviewers, which are not really, you know, good articles, the editors don't want to do that. So there's a lot of screen through at the initial process itself, and then once everything is fine, then it goes to the reviewers. Right? So at max, what the reviewers get is a certificate of appreciation from the publisher. Right? So if you are a reviewer in Springer or Elsevier, you'll get a certificate saying that, okay, you published, you reviewed so and so article. That supported the reviewers get. They don't get any, or they may get, you know, 10% off in ebook or 10% off in a journal, but they're not getting any kind of honorarium, so to say, for reviewing. So the editors are very, very specific about reviewing the articles much before it is actually reviewed. So please be careful on that. Some dull papers, if you want to say, you know, every statement has a reference. That's not good enough. You make it sound as if, you know, it's almost a discovery, but there is no discussion or results on that. There's no reasoning. The article is way too long. It just talks about studies which are existing, so on and so forth. So we don't need that. No originality, no focus. So these are some of the dull aspects, some of the aspects of a dull article. So that's about it from my side. I'll be more than happy to assist anybody in terms of research in my experience. It's not that I have achieved everything in research, but I'm also learning. But there are a few, about 12 years of my experience, which I can share. So I have put in my official and personal email ID. I put in my ORCID ID. All researchers are required to have an ORCID ID. Many high-impact journals have made it mandatory, so it's free to have an account in ORCID. I've also put in my ResearchGate profile so that I could you know, just suggest everybody to have a ResearchGate account. It's a very good website where you can share a whole lot of material with a whole lot of authors and also get back the materials. The only thing with ResearchGate, ResearchGate is that it requires an institutional email ID. You cannot have a personal ID to have an account, but if you have an institutional email ID, you can have a ResearchGate account. ResearchGate has really helped us. I've got actually books from authors, so it's that good. ORCID is required. Probably in another year or so, all journals will make ORCID. It will, your submissions will be linked to ORCID ID. So I hope I have given you a glimpse of article writing. I'll be with all of you for the next 2 days about project proposal writing. That's a different ball game altogether, but it is also associated with what we have done today. So I hope the session was useful for the participants. Any questions? I'm open to that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Dr. Sridhar. So the session is open for the questions. One of the question is asked by one of the participants. Sir, I will ask, is it ethical to submit article to more than one journal simultaneously? It was the one question posed by the participants.
Absolutely not. Because if you're submitting an article to two journals, I know why one would want to do that, because you're not sure what would be the result in journal A, therefore you're putting it in journal B. Absolutely not, it's unethical. And please remember that the same reviewers could show up in both the journals, right? Because your domain is the same, so the reviewer's domain is the same, and it has happened. It has happened. I have reviewed the same article in two journals. So if you are going very unlucky, I'm sorry to say, you can have a very, very bad day. So it's unethical. Please don't even think about these things. Just prepare your article to the best of the ability and then submit it in one journal. And of course, if it is a very high impact journal, you need to wait. For survey articles, you'll have to wait probably a year because they are long and reviewers are also busy. So please understand, reviewers are no special people, they are one of us. So the workload that you are having at your institute, the reviewers have the same kind of workload. So please put yourself in their shoes and think. So it will take time. I understand the problem that one may have faced, you know. And I'll be honest, even I was tempted to do that initially, you know. What will be the result in journal A? Let me put in journal B. But it's unethical. It should not be done. You'll be blacklisted from both the journals. And there are many other things that will happen. It's better not to go that route at all. So the answer to that is absolutely no.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Any other questions?
Yes, sir. Myself, Himlita Joshi. I'm from Maharashtra, sir. I have one question. I have completed my post graduation and now I want to pursue PhD. So is it necessary to that before PhD I should have some reputable journal papers published, or I can directly start working on a PhD topic?
That's a very good question, ma'am. What happens is, if you want to carry on with the work which you have done in your post-graduation, let's say MTech or Masters, if you want to carry on in the same domain, then you can always start with the publication before you even get registered in the PhD. But if you are changing domains, for example, my case was a change in the domain. In my Masters, I was working on vehicular networks, but then, over a period of time, I generated interest into optics, so I had to change. So for a brief period of about 1.5 years, I did not have any publications because I was reading through the optics part and so on. So it's not like mandatory, but it always helps to have publications even with or without being registered for PhD. Some would say it's good for your CV. I really don't go with enhancing the CV, because that's a part of that will automatically happen. I am more interested in enhancing my technical writing, the research abilities, the thinking, because research requires a certain kind of thinking. It cannot have the same thinking that we have in day-to-day life. It needs to have a different kind of thinking. We should try to ask more questions. That's another factor which I think I have missed out, but I will come to that tomorrow. Asking questions, that's an ability which we are tending to lose, but we should ask a whole lot of questions. you know, good research questions. So to answer your question, ma'am, it's always good to have publication. Please go ahead and have as many as you can before you even register, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, sir, and there is a lot of confusion between this impact factor and all regarding journals. So can you suggest some good reputed journals where we can publish the papers, like without even giving a thought about impact factor and all?
Okay, so I understand your case. Let's say there is a journal which is starting today. Okay, let's say the journal is started by IEEE, for example. Would the participants consider it to be a not good journal or a good journal? I think the answer to that would be it with the good journal, because it is indexed by IEEE. But then a question is, it is not having any impact factor, because to have an impact factor, you need to have at least 3 years of progression as a journal, right? So impact factor only comes into the picture after about 3 to 3.5 or 4 years. But what matters is who is publishing that particular journal, right? So if I have some kind of international journal of good, well, whether it will even survive, you know, I don't know that. But if it is a journal which is by IEEE, Elsevier, Springer, you know, these are established publishers. So in that case, I can go ahead and publish with those journals. You know, impact factor is only one of the metrics which will tell you that, okay, the journal is good, but that comes only after 3 to 4 years. So depending on your domain, many such journals are, you know, specified. That's why in my last slide, I put the link to ResearchGate. On ResearchGate, you'll find a whole lot of authors from your own domain who are working on many aspects, and they publish in many journals, which are really good, but we may not even have heard, because in our community here, we only hear about certain journals. So it's a good, you know, website to join. It's purely research oriented. It will give you a whole lot of ideas. So I think your answer, ma'am, may lie in a website like ResearchGate, rather than me suggesting a journal. But I would not go with any international journal of, you know, thinking whether it will survive or not, whether it is good or not. But if the publisher is good, you know, then I would go ahead with that.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Welcome.
Sir, another question: is there any open source softwares Turnitin to check the plagiarism, sir?
I didn't hear you properly, sir.
Yeah, open source software, sir, to check the plagiarism.
There are many which are available. You can go on Google and say, but they don't really check the plagiarism properly. And that's the problem, because they're open source. For example, there's something called as Grammarly, which checks your grammar. But again, part of it is open source, part is not. So you're really not sure. So if you really want to check, Turnitin is the one that is used. I know it has a cost associated with it. The institute may probably provide you, because they can buy it in a bulk. There are some institutes which you know, rent it out, in the sense that you can go and get your article checked there with a price that you can have. So I would, for plagiarism, I would go with a trusted you know, vendor. I would definitely go with only Turnitin. Of course, the benchmark institute, so to say, like IITs or NITs, would have iThinticate. But Turnitin is the minimum that I would go with. Anything open source, there was a time where people used to use a software called as Viper, V-I-P-E-R. It would do a job for a UG student, probably, in their project report, but not for us, in the sense, if you want to give it to a journal. So I would definitely go, bare minimum would be Turnitin, not an open source software.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, welcome.
Any other questions? I hope all the questions were clear. Thank you, sir, sharing your valuable information on scientific article writing, specifically abstract writing with 200 words and emphasizing on the importance, typical article structure and the tools used for plagiarism and errors and major issues usually committed by all of us, like language mixing. That was really a wonderful session. Thank you once again on behalf of Kondagara College of Engineering. I would like to thank Dr. Sridhar Iyer, sir, for giving a wonderful session. Thank you, sir. Tomorrow, once again, we have a session with Dr. Sridhar Iyer on research project proposal preparation part one. So we'll meet once again in tomorrow. So I request all the participants to join the MS team before 5 minutes commencement of the session. Thank you. Thank you, one and all. We'll end the session. And the feedback link has been shared in the chat box. I request all the participants to kindly give the feedback. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.